I had a new roof put on my house about 2 years ago, and I made sure that I got shingles that were rated at the very highest wind speed that is available. Also, I was lucky enough to look around and I found a roofer. This is an important point. You got to find a roofer who does it the old way with copper nails and a hammer. Do not hire anybody who uses a nail gun, because this roofer, his grandparents started the business, and he told me that he says if you don't put those nails right along that line, there's a line that's on the shingle. If you miss that line, you are not securing the shingles, and soon after you install the shingles, they're going to be falling off, even without winds. So you got to make sure you get an old-time roofer. Pay him an extra $1,000. I paid an extra $1,000. It cost me $8,000 to have the roof put on. But and he used copper nails, because galvanized nails will rust out. So that's what you have to do. That's the number one thing to do. But that's for winds. Secondly, for cars. Many people are going to have their cars totaled by baseball-sized hail and softball-sized hail. I've got many reports from the Weather Channel proving that this is the case in many parts of the country, North Dakota and Oklahoma. Baseball size, softball size. It's just incredible. And of course, your car will be totaled and many people will be killed. One of the ideas that, are you still there?
Yes, I am. I'm listening.
Okay. One of the ideas that I had was to get car covers. And Clay, you might want to do this. Get a sponsor. I'll bet you can really sell a lot of car covers this way. You get a car cover, somebody who has an excess of car covers, they're willing to sell them cheap, and maybe somebody in your audience who wants to be enterprising and make some money. You find a way to heat seal a bubble type envelope or a plastic sheet inside of that, on the underside of that car cover, so that it's not inflated, it should be inflatable, but when it's not inflated, you could roll it up and put it in your trunk. And then if you're driving along and your NOAA weather radio, that's another thing you have to do, is get a NOAA weather radio. Your NOAA weather radio tells you there's a hailstorm approaching. You can, pull the car over if you got time, put that car cover on, plug it into your car, plug in a tire pump, electric tire pump into the cigarette lighter of your car, and quickly pump up, inflate the underside of that car cover and protect your car from being totaled. The insurance companies will soon not be able to have to default. They soon will not be able to cover all the claims that are going to be hitting them for
now,
damaged cars.
John, has this brown dwarf has that been spotted? I mean, obviously the media is controlled. They don't want to panic. They don't want people knowing that it's coming. But I've heard reports from Nassau and other places that they've spotted, as a matter of fact, they've even spotted a solar system that's just a few hundred light years away, pretty close,
right,
in galaxy terms.
It definitely has been spotted a number of times. The first time it was sighted, it was in 1983. And this was when the federal government of the United States was not in their most sinister mode of information control, and somebody made at the top rungs of the evil government hierarchy overlooked this article, and the truth got out accidentally. This was in the New York Times, January 30th, 1983. I went to my library and photocopied, got a high-resolution photocopy of the actual newspaper articles that the government of the United States regretted that they ever allowed to get out. January 30th, 1983, I'm reading it right now, New York Times. Clues Get Warm in the Search for Planet X, by John Noble Wilford. Quote, something out there beyond the farthest reaches of the known solar system seems to be tugging at Uranus and Neptune. Some gravitational force keeps perturbing the two giant planets, causing irregularities in their orbits. The force suggests a presence far away and unseen, a large object that may be the long-sought planet X. And the article goes on to say that they're launching, the U.S. and the Netherlands were jointly launching the Infrared Astronomical Satellite, IRAS, into space, specifically defined Planet X. And in this article, they state that it is probably a brown dwarf star. And again, we found by definition a brown dwarf, a smaller, puny type of brown dwarf, would be about 1,000 Earth masses. Okay, that was January 30th, 1983. Ironically, exactly 11 months later, after this thing had been launched, the New York Times was heralding the prelude to the launch of this infrared astronomical satellite, specifically sent up to site Planet X. And then 11 months later, on December 30th, 1983, I've got the Washington Post article, which I also photocopied from the library archives. And here's the article, Washington Post, December 30th, 1983. Mystery heavenly body discovered, possibly as large as Jupiter. And that's an understatement, believe me. By Thomas O'Toole, Washington Post staff writer. A heavenly body, possibly as large as the giant planet Jupiter, and possibly so close to Earth that it would be part of this solar system, has been found in the direction of the constellation Orion by an orbiting telescope aboard the U.S. Infrared Astronomical Satellite. So mysterious is the object that astronomers do not know if it is a planet, a giant comet, a nearby protostar that never got hot enough to become a star, a distant galaxy so young that it is still in the process of forming its stars, or a galaxy so shrouded in dust that none of the light cast by its stars ever gets through. Okay, I won't read any more of the article, but they mention here it could be a protostar. This is exactly what it is. A protostar is a baby star that never got massive enough and never collected enough celestial dust encircling it to gravitationally pull it all in and compact it into a huge ball so tight with such tremendous internal gravitational forces, inward pulling gravitational forces, that it would actually get so hot that it would create nuclear fusion and thus create the energy like our sun does, enough energy to light up as our sun does. You see, our sun is estimated to be about 330,000 Earth masses. That's 1/3 of 1,000,000 Earth masses. This Planet X, of course, is just a puny little thing. Only about 1,000 Earth masses. So it never got hot enough, never got big enough to have nuclear fusion. Therefore, it became a slow, smoldering brown dwarf star. And it is on a cometary orbit. It comes in every 3,600 years, just like a pendulum. You can predict a period of a pendulum. And pendulums are used in the grandfather's clock. We've all seen a grandfather's clock, and the pendulum becomes one of the main timekeeping devices in the grandfather's clock, because the period of that pendulum, the time it takes to swing from one extreme back to the other, is highly uniform. Likewise, we have the ends of the pendulum inside and outside of our solar system are our sun. That's one end of the pendulum. And the other end is a distant dead sun about 50 billion miles away that has been actually, again from NASA, the New Science and Invention Encyclopedia, New Science and Invention Encyclopedia of 1987, got this information from NASA, and they said that there is a distant dead sun out there about which Planet X orbits on a long elliptical cometary orbit, just like a pendulum, or just like a clothesline. You know, one end of the pulley, one pulley on the clothesline might be likened to our sun, and the other end, the far end pulley, might be likened to this dead distant sun, and the clothesline itself then would describe the path of Planet X. So that's basically it. I mean, and
now, what about the Hubble telescope, John? We got that up there. I mean, why haven't they pointed that in that direction? I mean,
They have. They claim that it was defective, but that it failed. And it was the only reason why they said it failed was because they did not want to release any more photographs. But they themselves have been using the Hubble. It did not fail. They've been using it to site Planet X. I'm glad you brought that up. But then in later years now, here we've got the infrared astronomical satellite sighting Planet X in 1983. We have the Hubble telescope and sighting it, and they shut it down and told us that it was defective. And then later on, we have the South Pole Telescope. Marshall Masters documented the construction of the South Pole Telescope in his book Planet X Forecast.